welcome to the Lee Mack Show. Please welcome this week's special musical guest. It's Jamelia.
People always talk about ayo, ayo, all the things they're all about. Ayo, 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 write it on a piece of paper. I got a feeling I'll see you later. I don't know what it is that makes me feel like this. I don't know who you are, but you must be some kind of superstar. 'Cause you got all eyes on you no matter where you are. Oh, I don't know what it is that makes me feel like this. I don't know who you are, but you must be some kind of superstar. 'Cause you got all eyes on you no matter where you are. Oh no, it's all eyes on you.
Of course, by the brilliant Steve Brown. What have you been up to this week, Steve?
I've been doing a lot of walking, especially at night. It's when I start thinking about things, things I've done, things I shouldn't have done. I need to tell someone what I've done.
Steve Brown, ladies and gentlemen! So, it's great to be here, London town, any proper cockneys in? All right, leave it out, geezer. I love that little dance I did there for you. Like I was selling play. Do you ever look at someone who's so cockney it looks like it hurts? Oh, mate, leave it out. I'm out of hell. I'm so cockney. I can only move my arms and my legs and I'm safe. I'm all riddled with cockneys like I've got arthritis. I wish I was Norman. It seems so easy. I hate it. I am so cockney. It hurts. You see, I'm Lancashire, so when you're Lancashire, I haven't got a proper Lancashire accent, by the way. Proper Lancashire accent is just surprised to hell about everything. Oh, I went to the shop today, bought some peas. Looks inside, there were peas. But great, I bought some shoes from Shoe Shop. Amazing. My favourite accent is actually the South African accent. I don't know if we've got any South Africans in tonight. It always sounds to me like a South African accent is just our accent played backwards on a record player, isn't it? You know when you get an album and you record it backwards, and then when you play it backwards, it sounds forwards? That's what it sounds like to me, South African. Hello, my name's Lee, and I'm from England. Get out of my country, I hate you. I don't like you, leave me here. I come from Johannesburg. Kill your parents, kill them, kill them, kill your parents. Beelzebub, Beelzebub. Whereas an Australian just sounds like a record that won't start properly, doesn't it? Where are you from, mate? I'm from Melbourne, mate. How long have you lived there for? About 14 years. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to meet my regular guests. What can I say about this woman? She can act, she can sing, she can dance, but more importantly, she can cook. Please welcome Angela McHale!
Cook.
Sorry, I forgot cleaning and decorative cake making.
Shall I tell you something about these intros?
They're a standalone comedy piece that are so good they're worthy of their own 12-part spin-off series.
Have another go. I'll give you a clue. It rhymes with a load of sexist frolics.
Doesn't matter that it's sexist, because I'm doing it in an ironic way.
Why is it ironic?
Oh, don't worry your pretty little head about the details, sweetheart. See, I did it again.
Yeah, another sexist barb.
Hey, it's Barbara to you.
So you think all this stuff's acceptable because it's ironic?
Listen, don't knock it. Postmodern irony's great. You can get away with murder. Watch this. I'll pick on someone from another country. Where are you from, madam?
England.
England. Yeah, it's not going to work unless you pretend you're from another country. Try and get it right, you silly cow, and listen to what I'm saying. And that wasn't postmodern irony. That was from the heart. Say Germany. Okay. Where are you from? Germany? Well, here's a joke for you. There was a man, and he walks into the pub with a chicken on his head. Yeah, a chicken. Can you imagine this? How peculiar. So the barman says, you must leave the pub immediately, for that is against the hygiene regulations. And so the man leaves, and once again, normal order is resumed. Bum bum. Come on, laugh! Shell! Shell!
You are not being ironic, you're being moronic.
Yeah, and you're being overly sensitive. Typical of the lady sex.
I prefer fairer sex.
Well, wouldn't we all, but it's very hard to police. But, you know, come on, what are the rules? I get so confused.
The rules are simple. If you're a woman, you can do jokes about women. If you're German, you can do jokes about the Germans.
What if you're a German woman?
Then you can do jokes about German women.
And shaving. Yeah, you laugh now. So you're saying that because I'm northern, I can only make jokes about northern people?
And inbred people, slow people, ugly people.
Ah, see, so you're saying that all northerners...
No, just you.
Look, shall we just bring on the first act?
Have you learnt your lesson?
I certainly have. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to meet our first guest. What can I say about this man? He can act, he can sing, he can dance, but more importantly, he accepts that he doesn't understand the concept of postmodern ironic humour as well as the fairer sex.
Can you just say I'm from Luton?
Please welcome John Hegley!
Okay, you've had the fun, now the poetry. Okay, give me a bit of a. Give me this. You look good, yeah, you look good. Through your peephole, you see people as you should. You look good, mm-hmm, you look good. You look at trees and these do not obscure the wood. You look good, mm-hmm, you look good. You see the Christmas that is in the Christmas pud. You look good, mm-hmm, you look good. And I'd give you more examples if I could. Okay, this is a poem that Lee asked me to do. It's called Early Dealings with Our Daughter. That morning, she's a month old. I hold on to her littleness and ask her, where are your teeth? Where are they? Where are your teeth? Thanks. This is a bit with a bit of joining in for you. Okay, so when I sing Luton Bungalow, so I'm going to show them how to do it. And in our Luton Bungalow, then I want you to go low, low, Luton Bungalow. Okay, you can do this at home as well. Or in the car. In our Luton bungalow, wait for it, and better.
Luton bungalow.
Never give too much in a rehearsal. My mother was of Kentish stock from Ramsgate by the sea. She cleaned the place around the clock and around the settee. She cleaned the household surfaces like she had to get below the surface of existence in our Luton bungalow. Come on, give it to me. The day I started out for infant school, my older brother told me to remember three words. Girls never prosper. Now I don't know where my brother got this strange motto, but because he was my example, I repeated those words to everyone I met, and I did not get a girlfriend until I was 27. But I had a boyfriend at 15. In our Luton bungalow. When my father got angry, there was lava, there was foam. But the corners of my father's mouth, but still it felt like half. I would hit my sister, then someone else hit me. Then all of us went down the church to say that we were sorry. And the Lord gave us forgiveness, and all of us would go back for further beating in our Luton bungalow.
Bringing a bit of class to the proceedings, well, don't you worry, because I've written a poem myself. And this one is entitled Old Age Pensioner's Knickers. Roses are red, violets are blue, Ethel's are green. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to meet our musical guest, Jamelia!
Jamelia, you're breaking my heart, you're shaking my confidence daily, Jamelia.
Jamelia, can I start by saying you are a beautiful woman, you've got a beautiful personality, and of course, you've got a beautiful singing voice.
Thank you, that's very kind of you to say.
Do you ever look at yourself in the mirror and think, God must have given me this Brummie accent just to balance it all up a bit?
Hey, there's nothing wrong with a Brummie accent.
Well, why don't you use it when you're singing?
I don't know what it is that makes me feel like this. Superstar.
Actually, that wouldn't work, would it?
No.
Now, you can't say the words Jamelia without saying the words R and B. Well, my brother can't anyway, he's dyslexic. The question is this. Which do you prefer, R or B?
What are you on about?
Well, if you had to have just one, would you have R and R or B and B? Actually, you could have both, couldn't you? If you needed a bit of R and R, you could go to a B and B.
Do you drink?
No. Now, as well as the music, you also have other professional sidelines, don't you?
That's right. In 2004, I signed up with a model agency, ICM.
And how's that been going?
Very well. I was recently asked to be the new legs and face of Pretty Polly.
Oh, the things that make you wear in these pantos.
It's not a panto.
Nothing to be ashamed of. I spent a whole winter season as the back end of a singing sheep in Oops, Vicar, That's My Cock.
Pretty Polly is a company that makes stockings and tights.
Well, I can understand the legs bit, but how could you be the face of that? What were you going to do, rob a bank?
Can we talk about the music?
Of course we can. In fact, let's talk about your awards.
Yes, last year I was nominated for my fifth MOBO.
MOBO?
Music of Black Origin.
Oh, of course. Actually, I think I might be in with a shout myself this year. Not the MOBOs, obviously. No, I'm up for a Music of French Origin.
Really?
Well, that's what the public are saying. They keep leaning out to the cars when I'm walking down the road and shouting, Lee Matt, you are a mofo!
Is that what you like then, French music?
Not really.
Well, who do you like?
Moloko.
Oh yeah, I really like their last album.
No, Moloko, music of Latvian and Kosovan origin. Now, it's fair to say that you've had an incredibly successful 6 years, haven't you?
Yeah, it certainly seems a long time since my first single, So High.
Actually, I've got a bit of a confession to make. I actually lost my virginity to So High. What a summer that was, 1986.
I released it in 1999.
No, So High was a Vietnamese prostitute.
I don't want to know.
Okay, let's not talk about it now. We'll put the clap on in the edit. I've got one final question for you. Will you be in this week's sketch? We're doing The Shining. You play my wife, who I try and chop up into little pieces.
That sounds horrific.
It's not a real axe.
No, the wife bit.
Play the music.
Shine on the harvest moon up in the sky.
So, Jack, do you think you and your family will be able to cope with being the caretaker of the Overlook Hotel? It can get pretty lonely up here in the winter.
I'll be perfect. I'll finally get to finish my first novel.
Oh, what's it called?
Love in the Stables by Jilly Cooper. I started it in 92, I'm a bit of a slow reader. Yeah.
So, is there anything else we need to know about the hotel?
What do you mean, like, have there ever been any murders here? Because actually, it's funny you should mention that. There's something that I need to talk to you about, Mrs. Torrance.
Please, call me Wendy.
Sorry, I can't do that. I'm busy on Wednesday. The thing is, this hotel has a history of sending people a bit bonkers, shall we say. It's the isolation.
You should change it. All that asbestos wall cavity stuff is lethal.
It's the isolation, not the insulation. Insulation doesn't send you bonkers.
You've obviously never spent an afternoon trying to fit it with a pair of nail scissors.
The thing is, in the 1930s, there was a bit of an incident at the hotel.
What do you mean, a bit of an incident?
The caretaker, a man by the name of Delbert Grady, ran amok and killed his whole family and then blew his own brains out.
Well, thank God it wasn't a lot of an incident.
So are you looking forward to staying here, Danny?
Red rum, red rum.
Sorry, he's a bit deaf. He thought you said, who's the only horse to win the Grand National 3 times?
Red rum is murder backwards.
Yeah, he can't see the fences coming.
Red rum.
What's with the strange voice?
Oh, sorry, didn't I tell you? She's from Birmingham.
Red rum.
Can you actually say anything else?
Desert orchid.
Hi, I'm the head chef, Dick.
And I'm the new caretaker, Knobhead.
Don't worry about your son, Mr. Torrance. He just has the shining.
What's the shining, Dick?
Sounds like one of those luminous condoms.
Ignore my husband. What's the shining, Dick?
Please, call me Wendy. The shining is a... The shining is a kind of telepathy. I remember when I was Danny's age, I would have whole conversations with my grandmother without her once opening her mouth.
Ah, mine used to do that. It's infuriating, isn't it? Just open your mouth, Nan. I promise not to steal your teeth again. Right. I'll leave you lunatics to chat. I'm off to find that barman of yours, Lloyd. See if he can fix me another drink.
Lloyd? There's no Lloyd here. No one of that name has worked here for over 50 years.
What about me?
Oh, yeah, sorry, Lloyd, I forgot about you.
There you go, Lloyd. That should cover it.
But I don't want it covered. I like to get a bit of air on it now and again.
I meant the bill. Having said that, since you mentioned it, maybe you should put it away. It was a conversation piece at first, but now you just look unprofessional.
I wish I'd never brought it up.
Yeah. Yeah, that didn't help either. You know, Lloyd, you seem very familiar to me.
Is it because I keep being overly friendly and touching your body?
No, there's something about you.
I think you're mistaken, Mr. Torrance. Another drink?
Why not? I mean, I'm not an alcoholic or anything. I just do it until the screaming in my head stops. Hang on, I think I know where you're from. Haven't I seen your photo in Real Life Hotel Murders Monthly?
Okay. It's time to lay it on the table.
Please, I don't want to see it again.
My name's not really Lloyd. It's Grady. Delbert Grady.
Join us later for part two!
Please put your hands together for Jamelia!
You're trying to be big about it. You're constantly just denying. You're like a mop to a flame. Holly way. But listen, cause I know what I'm saying. He's trying to catch you in it, and then he will back you in it. Cause he's just another girl addict. And if you give it away, you gotta be crazy, crazy. Stop, you better shake him off before he gets out. He's coming to get ya, he's coming to get you. Stop, he'll only build you up and then forget ya. He's dirty to the bone. Well, I was damn near addicted. I got in trouble with him. I got in trouble with him. Where everything was just how he wanted. But then I got wise, I got out of sight. So take my advice, you better shake him off before he gets shy. He's coming to get you, yeah, he's coming to get you. Stop, he'll only build you up and then forget ya. He's dirty to the bone, beware of the dog. You better shake him off before he gets shy. He's coming to get ya, coming to get ya. Stop, he'll only build you up and then forget.
Like to read a poem. Jamelia, Jamelia, can I have a feel at you? Yeah, forget it. Could have been worse. I was going to do a limerick about a woman from China. And something, let me tell you, was enormous. Now, I shouldn't be flirting, of course, with Jamelia because I am actually in a relationship at the moment. She's a lovely girl. She actually works in a cosmetic factory testing cosmetics on animals. She's a lovely girl, and she hates my job because I'm always trying my jokes out on her. You know, fair enough, she's always rubbing shampoo in my eyes.
Meanwhile, back at the Overlook Hotel.
Ah, Mr. Torrance, your usual.
Well, I think I am. Having said that, I have been talking to a ghost for the past 6 weeks. Actually, there's something I've been wondering. Are they real ghosts too?
Which ones?
The little dwarfs over there with the white sheets over their heads.
They're tables.
So come on, Delbert, we've got to know each other a bit, but you still haven't told me. Why did you do it?
Well, you were sat down in your shorts, your knee was just in front of me, and let's face it, if I needed somewhere to rest it...
Not that. What you did to your family.
My family didn't like this hotel, so they said they wanted to leave, so I corrected them.
Corrected?
I chopped them up with an axe.
Yeah, remind me not to do a spelling test with you.
You seem rather low, sir.
Do I?
Yes, sir. Let me give you a cushion. Come on, that's better.
Actually, I'm a bit cheesed off. I've decided to write a book, but I can't finish it.
I didn't know you were an author, sir.
I'm not, that's the problem. But when I met Wendy, I told her I was a writer to impress her. All I meant was I could do proper joined-up writing with a pen, but And even then, I was bluffing a bit. But where I come from, that's normally enough to loosen a bit of knicker elastic. And, you know, I think I'm a bit of a disappointment to her.
Women, eh? You know what they say, you can't live with them.
You can't live without them.
What actually I was going to say was, can't live with them, so maybe you should simply kill her and be done with it.
Look, I've told you, I'm not killing my wife.
Oh, come on.
I mean, correct me if I'm wrong. Actually, don't correct me, forget that. But
come on. You'll never know until you try. The whole point of coming away on a winter trip like this is to try and find yourself, and you know, better to have tried to kill your family and failed than never to have tried at all.
Red rum, red rum, red rum.
Oh, God, here comes little Lord Mentalroy.
Right, I'm off. I know this might sound odd coming from a ghost who cut up his own family, but I find your son a bit weird. I'll be next door.
Yeah, I don't think we need that sound effect. He's supposed to be a ghost.
I smell the blood of Satan.
Oh, do you? I don't suppose you fancy popping out with your daddy and catching tadpoles like normal little boys, do you?
I see dead people.
Right, I'll take that as a no, you little freak.
Hey, don't call our son a freak. The correct term is normally challenged. I want to leave this hotel. It's starting to give me the creeps.
Oh, come on. It's hardly the creeps. The heebie-jeebies, maybe.
How are the creeps any different from the heebie-jeebies?
I don't know, they're a bit more knockabout. Light-hearted.
Okay, this hotel is giving me the heebie-jeebies.
It's fine, there's nothing wrong with it. Having said that, I know a barman who keeps giving me the willies.
Help us, help us.
Have you been seeing those twins again?
Oh, it was a month ago. And how do you know about that?
I was talking to Danny.
Oh.
And what were you talking about?
Nothing. Maybe you're right. Maybe we should leave. Centre Parks, anyone?
Have you been two-timing me?
Well, three-timing, technically. Put the axe down, love.
Danny! This is Mr. Halloran! Can you hear me, Danny?
Yeah, it might help if you get out of the bin, mate.
Oh, yeah, that's better. I think you better tell your dad to run. Here's Mommy!
Stop! 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 Whoa, 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 whoa! What are you doing?
He said play some chase music during the sketch.
Yeah, not Benny Hill. It's not like Jamelia's running around in a bra and panties. Actually,
don't even think about it.
Hit the road, Jack. Don't come back no more, no more, no more, no more. Hit the road, Jack. And don't you come back no more. Oh no, hit the road, Jack. And don't you come back no more, no more, no more, no more. Hit the road, Jack. And don't you come back no more.
You've been listening to The Lee Mack Show with Lee Mack, John Hegley and Angela McHale, with music from Steve Brown, Mark Alice, Andy Hamill, Matt Backer, and this week's special musical guest, Jamelia. It was written by Lee Mack, Paul Carenza and Simon Evans, with additional material from Danielle Ward, and it was produced by Will Saunders.
And don't you come back no more.